So today I came across an article about a woman who had met a man on Plenty of Fish, and on their date, he got very mad at her. They were parked at a boat launch. She got very mad because she wasn't putting out the way he wanted. So he got very irate and he drove her car into the river at the lake. And she swam out to safety, and I guess he got out and walked away. It's on the it's on a newspaper article. And one of the ladies was commenting that when she was briefly dating, that men would get very irate with her when she refused to get in their car. I think that it's very risky behavior to be too friendly too quickly with people we don't know. I think it's very risky behavior for a woman to just invite a man off a dating app or any man into her home. Don't do it. You don't have to do it to be nice or desperate or whatever it is. And to get into a man's car, the only reason men invite us into their cars if they don't know us, I think they're trying to get some booty when they drop us off. Like the gentleman, I don't know if you're watching my video, who wanted a free date from me from a place that's 45 minutes from my home, and he wanted to pick me up. I'm like, you gotta pay me then. Why would I spend 3 hours with some random guy from out of town? What would that do for me? And it's not safe. When the guy has me in his car, he's got all the power. And I don't like giving a stranger all the power over my physical safety. Anything could happen. They can lock the doors, they can drive off somewhere. I'm not paranoid. I take walks at night, but I'm not stupid. And another thing they do when they want to drive you, it's all about when they drop you off, especially if you've had something to drink. At best, they'll try to get a kiss when they walk you to the door. But maybe they'll get lucky and they'll get their dick wet. That's the real reason they want to pick you up. It's not about being a gentleman, because if it were about a gentleman being a gentleman, they wouldn't get upset when you refuse to get in their car or if you want money to go on the date. It's about what they want and on their terms. See, ladies, I think some people are too walled off and mean, and some people are too nice and too trusting. And I also, it's a kind of a fine line to walk. I don't want to be, I don't want to be walled off, and I don't want to be too trusting. So I think a good model is to kind of think of people as they don't deserve our trust if we don't know them. The more we know them, the more we can trust them, the more vulnerable we can be. But I've made the mistake of, oh, you seem like a nice person, so I become intimate and vulnerable and trusting too quickly. Because, see, a lot of these people who are, well, here's the thing. Just because someone's nice doesn't mean that they can handle their anger or their disappointment or that they're reliable or consistent. That's why, I mean, just for like dating situations or getting into a guy's car, it really helps if we know that person somewhat. Because a lot of people can be really nice when they're trying to get something from you. They're trying to get a date, they're trying to get your attention or free phone calls or texting. They want your attention, they want your time, might maybe want your body. And I'm not saying all men do this. I know a lot of cool guys watch my videos. This is about vetting. Men, you have to vet women too. This video is for me. I'm speaking as a woman and my experience with men and what they can do and why we have to vet men. And maybe this will help some of you guys understand why women are not so quick to trust you, because a lot of things can happen. You're physically stronger than us. You have a higher sex drive, and you're men who can't handle a no or who are violent or dangerous, they mask around with very nice, friendly faces. So I don't know if you're actually nice. I don't know if you're authentic or you're playing a game. Now, with some guys, I can pick out looking at them. I'll be like, that guy's a player. That guy's got mental health issues. That guy, you know. But some guys are very smooth. Like this guy that was trying to take me out twice and blew me off. He was very smooth. He was like a firefighter, tall, good-looking guy. Those are the guys you got to watch out for. I didn't mention the tall firefighter part before because, but I think he's, you know, they've got their charm on, they got their game on. And, but even other guys who are just smooth talkers, they know how to get women into situations that we shouldn't get into. So we need to vet men before we ever get into their car. And actually, I think we have to vet them before we even go on a date. Like, are you actually going to show up for this date? I don't know. It's really a hard line to walk between, am I closed off to life? Am I too guarded? Or am I, you know, just being, you know, but I will tell you this because I work with men. There's a certain man who understands women, who understands that women need to feel safe, and they'll approach a woman from, what do you need to feel safe? Would you like to meet me there? Where do you like to eat? And it feels like they're actually present. I think we have to really listen to our like signals from our body. Like, is my body saying a yes to this person, even talking to them, or does it seem like I should do it, or I should do it because he wants to, or I should do it because I should be open to life? I'm trying to just come more in touch with like, what are the things that I do because I kind of picked up growing up that I should be nice? That's not my inner body telling me what's safe. I also want to say something about me just wanting to date men who are family men. I'm not judging people who don't have families. A lot of people have very giving relationships with their nieces or nephews. That's family. Or with their animals, with their cats or their dogs or their horses. And I guess if you're a person who's really into dogs and loves dogs, you probably want to date someone who also likes dogs. If you were to date someone who doesn't like dogs and has never had a dog and they're in their 40s, they probably don't like dogs. Is that a person you want to date? Or if you're a person who really likes to travel, would you want to date someone who has never traveled? They probably don't like to travel. So it's about finding people who are similar. I know people that I met a lady once at this retreat earlier this year who had no kids. She was in her late 40s and she married a guy who had no kids because she wanted a guy who had no kids. So that's it. We can all have our own preferences. My thing was, I think I was just being too easygoing. I'm like, oh, someone asked me out on a date. That's great. I'm always about men asking women out on a date. I finally got a date, but I wasn't really into him, so I should have just said no. And I didn't say no because I didn't want to be walled off or not open to possibilities. And I thought, well, maybe I should just say yes. But I really should have told this guy, you know, if we meet again a few more times and I like you, yeah, but right now, no, I'm not feeling it. But then I judged myself. So what I worked on with my therapist yesterday was listening to my inner voice and not to the inner voice of my mother. My mother, I'm not trying to blast her as a bad person, but I got a lot of messages, you know, I should be more loving, I should be more kind. And those are well-intended messages, but they bypass, those kind of things bypass me getting. My body gives me feedback and bypassing it to be in my head of like, this is what I should do and this is what feels right. I mean, this is what's right and this is what I should do. Doesn't serve me. So ever since yesterday when I had the session with her, I've been more thinking about what is my body telling me about if I'm a yes or no to this or how I feel about this. Because I think all of us, we all as children had to bypass what we wanted because we were told what to do and what to think and how to sit in chairs in school. Fortunately, here's a little thing about school. I was in Germany the first three grades, and I hated sitting in a chair for hours. And so I asked the teacher if I could stand up behind the chair. And she let me. She said I could. So I was the only kid standing up. Everybody was sitting. Well, now we label kids who don't like sitting as ADD. I wasn't like a fidgety kid, but come on, no kid wants to sit in a fucking chair when they're 6 years old for hours. That's unhealthy. That's just one example of how kids have to push down what they really want. School is a prime place where kids are diminished. You know, they're told that they have to sit, and if they don't like to sit, they're the problem. They're told what they have to study. They're told what's important to learn, what's important to think about. And if a kid likes to draw or run or sing in today's school system, there's no space or allowance for that. You got to push that all down. So it's like really nice to just get back in touch with, well, what do I really want to do? Not what are my voices in my head telling me that's from what my parents told me or what the teachers told me. And then what are the parts of myself that are asleep because they could never be awakened? Have you ever had to, you know, got into a fight with your sibling and then, you know, like say they just took a toy from you and you argue with them and then you're told you can't argue, you got to make up and say sorry. But this person took my toy, that's not right. You know, you got to push down all the stuff. So part of being an adult is just kind of waking up. And the problem is, in these strangers that we meet, they might look like they have it all together, like the firefighter. He looked like he had it all together, or whoever it is. But if we could peek inside their brains and see what's really going on, like, what are the areas of their brain that have to do with compassion, empathy, and reliability, and kindness and self-emotional regulation? I want to see which parts are light up white as healthy, or black, which are unactivated, or dark because they're angry. We can't see that in people. A lot of people can mask their stuff really well. I'm sure the woman who went with the guy who drove her into the lake had no idea that he would drive her into a lake. So, you know, people have to reveal who they are. I'm at the point where I'm like, I don't even know if these people can keep a date. They say they want to go out. I have another dating story for you guys. So I'm always give a little bit of higher precedence to guys I meet in real life. So I was out with this woman I was doing some business coaching with, I guess it was a couple years ago. And we were at this restaurant, and this gentleman who was our server, this was when I was still considering guys who were 30. He was a 30-year-old server. He's like, oh, I recognize you off your Twitter, you know. And I ended up taking a picture with him. And then on the way home, I was like, ooh, that guy was kind of cool. I'd gotten his Instagram, I think, or his Twitter. And I posted the picture of us together. And then somehow he ended up, he wanted to get together, and I told him I only go out with men who first take me to dinner. It was very hard getting a dinner date. It almost felt like pulling teeth or arguing with him because he was inconsistent about messaging me, about making the dinner date. And then he finally made the dinner date, but it was like pulling teeth. He came over, he actually picked me up. We had a nice dinner date. I made a video about it at the time. He dropped me off. He walked me in and he kissed me. And it was a really good kiss. I have to say it was a really good kiss. Just a 5-second kiss. And then he left. And I never saw him again. Not because I didn't want to see him again. he just blew me off. In fact, he made a date with me after that. We were going to go hiking, and he didn't show up to the hiking date. Okay. Now, he's a good looking guy. He's a server. He's a server at a very popular place in Encinitas. And servers are usually very charming and outgoing. This guy was. And so not all guys want sex. That's what I'm saying. I don't know what his motive was, but funnily enough, another woman about my age, a friend of a mutual friend, asked me if I'd gone out with this guy. I'm like, yeah, how do you know? Somehow, I don't know how she figured I'd gone out with him, because he liked older women and she'd also gone out with him, and they had gone to a brewery and had a beer. And after that, I don't know if he drove her home or she just met him there. She never heard from him again. He just blew her off. So see how they treat one person is how they treat everyone. So here's the weird thing about, there are guys out there who, they're not looking for sex. They just want to go out or not go out. They blow off dates. So I'm like, I don't even want to accept dates anymore unless I get like some kind of a deposit or something. Like I get a deposit for my coaching business. People have to pay money before I take them like it's prepaid for my coaching appointments. And I know this sounds really weird, but this is what I feel like I need to do. Like, give me some money, like $100. When I meet you at the date, I'll give you your $100 back. That's what I feel I need to do anymore, because so many people will blow off dates. I had another guy I was supposed to go on a date with, and he called me an hour before to cancel, and that was fine. After that, I decided, you know, I'm only going to go on dates with people where I would go on that date anyway. Even if you cancel, I would still have a good time going there. But I don't always feel that way. Sometimes I'm like, well, I'm just going to go there if it's a date. I don't want to go there by myself, depending on my mood. But I think it could be a good system. And some guy might be like, well, I'm not going to pay you a deposit to make sure I show up. But that's what I would really want, because I'm like, I'm tired of people not really, I think some people are not self-aware enough. That's what I think. I don't think they're purposely doing it. I think that some people are not really self-aware to be like, how committed. I'm pretty self-aware. Like, I will only schedule something with someone if I'm really sure that I'm going to make it, and I'm not going to cancel if a better offer comes up. And I don't cancel if a better offer comes up. I have in the past, but I'm not in that place anymore. And I think when people have to pay, it forces them to check in with themselves about, I'm not really that interested in going out with her. I was just saying that. I think it makes them more self-aware if they really want to do it. It also makes them check in about whether they really trust me. They have to trust me to show up. They have to trust me to pay the money back. And they have to trust themselves to keep their word. But if they don't trust me, I don't really care, because I don't know you anyway. So I think you have to prove yourself to me. Else I don't really want to go. I think if I knew someone really well and like, oh, we already know each other, I wouldn't do it. But otherwise, I'm going to start saying this to guys. Okay, here's the thing. I know you want to go out with me, and I'm definitely interested in dating people. However, I don't know you. I don't know if you're actually going to show up or cancel. So here's my deal. Here's my offer to you. If we keep running into each other in the same place, and I start feeling like I trust you and you're really interested in me, I may accept a date with you. If you want to go on a date right now with me not really knowing you, I would like a deposit, which I will reimburse you when we get on the date. If this doesn't feel congruent for you, I totally understand. No hard feelings at all. Just keep coming back to where you met me, and at some point, maybe I'll agree to the date. But right now, I haven't vetted you, to the point where I even trust you to show up for the date. So here's my offer, take it or leave it. And I think that's really fair. I think that's really fair. I feel pretty good about that. Even though I judge myself as, that's a weird thing, but that's what I feel like. So many people, I was just talking to someone the other day, somebody around my age, who is very experienced with people and works with people. And he said that people nowadays treat each other as so disposable. It's the disposable society. You know, it's a disposable society. And people treat each other as objects. You know, people have lost that sense of connection to their community. And I'm going to say, this is maybe going off on a tangent now with the economy. A lot of it, too, is how workers treat their employees has become very callous. People, companies don't value their employees like they used to. It's all about how many additional percentage points of profit can I eke out of these workers? And there's a thing now in China called giving up or something. I forgot the word. It came up on Breaking Points yesterday, and it's just another example of how people around the world are just kind of at their wit's end. So many people are working the hours that they are expected from their employer for the low pay that they get, unable to even pay their food and their rent, and just feeling like, what is this life I signed up for? It's happening here, it's happening in China, it's happening all over the world. So people are treated as objects by their employer. You know, they're on social media and seeing each other. They're not. We've lost our sense of community and caring about each other. And I don't want to accept dates with people that aren't vetted. I'd rather just be alone, you guys. So the question kind of is, what can I do to be a different person? But right now I'm just kind of assimilating it all and just really feeling like, you know, I can be home. And right now I am talking. I have someone to talk to, which is my camera. I'm going to put it on YouTube. So I feel like I am interacting a little bit. I think that society has changed a lot. We have kind of lost our sense of community. People have become really mobile. There's a lot of job insecurity, income insecurity. Women are not working and they're not as desperate to have a man. They're saying, why do I need a man? An economic incentive was a big reason. Having children was a big reason. A lot of women don't want children and they make their own money. And so they're getting more choosy about who they're in relationship with. Also, I think the best time to get into a relationship is in your 20s. When people wait after that, there are fewer people left, and the people that are left usually have a lot of issues. Like this firefighter guy, he didn't have a kid until he didn't even have kids till he was in his 40s. Maybe that's fine, but he didn't even marry the woman. Like, that is just weird to me. It shows that they never really got along. And then I think a lot of people are not picky enough because guys like him and guys like Umi Iduku and all these athletes who cheat, all these athletes, they cheat. They need a woman who's easygoing. That's another thing. That Umi Iduku, I'm going to make a separate video on that. So this video is about getting in touch with our body, giving us signals and not telling us, well, I should be nice, I should be okay with this. If you feel like someone has abandoned you, they probably have, unless you have like abandonment issues. If you feel like someone is leading you on, they probably are. If you feel like someone is playing games with you, they probably are. So here's the point, is to start listening to our own inner voice and finding our own inner sense of safety in our bodies. That's, you know, what I kind of wanted to talk about. And that we have to vet men because they have to prove. We're the vulnerable species. They have to prove that they're safe. This is what men have to prove. They have to prove that they're safe, that they're reliable, and that they care about us. And this whole sexual revolution, women are like men and we're all equals in the workplace, but not in our personal lives, because they can still hurt us. They can still hurt us, and they use their words to lead us on. And I'm sure women do things to lead men on. This video is about me as a woman speaking about my experience with men. And that's what this video is about. Yes. And how does it feel? Does it feel soothing to my soul? Do I not trust it? And I don't have to say yes. Doesn't make me closed off. It's just listening to my body. And that's what I'm working on. What is my feelings telling? What are my feelings telling me? And thank you for watching my video.